Let's pray together. Father, if ever we doubted how great you truly are, to be reminded that you took enemies and made them friends, that you took enemies and made them sons and daughters, adopted them into your family, gave them the full rights of sonship, made them heirs to the glories of your kingdom, that you have granted to your sons and daughters the rights of sonship, and that you have given them the righteousness of your begotten Son, the Lord Jesus. My heart is joyful and it is overwhelmed to consider how gracious you are. And in singing what we did this evening, I am all the more grieved, Father, that we as your people are so quickly carnal. Oh, how I pray you would lift up our hearts, that you would stir our affections, that you would create in us such a sense, such a holy discontentment, that we long to be more perfect, more holy, more mature, more complete, that we would delight in putting off things pertaining to the old man, and that we would run with haste to put on the virtues that are characterized by love and joy and peace and righteousness. How I pray that we as your people would be marked by what Jesus was marked with. Where we are not, would you expose in us the sin that is so easily able to ensnare us? Would you draw us to repentance, and would we find joy, genuine joy, in being restored to fellowship with you again? And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, take your Bible, if you would, this evening, and let's go back to Corinthians. We're going to begin in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. This matter of the carnal Christian is such that I want to take more time to begin to think about it this evening in hopes of not only exposing carnality in our own lives, but hopefully eradicating it from our lives. Before we get into the sermon this evening, I was just last week or perhaps the week before that showing hospitality toward one of the families in our church that have been visiting now 5 or 6 times. And I think I've told you in the past that one of the things that I always ask those families when we have the privilege of being with them is whether or not they view us as a hospitable church, whether or not we are friendly to them. And immediately, I was encouraged by this, immediately that family responded, "This is the friendliest church we've ever been a part of." People come up to us before the service, introduce themselves to us, and look genuinely like they want to know about our lives. Let me commend you for that. If you are one of the ones who on Sunday morning, instead of just walking in and getting your seat because we're kind of tight in here, so you just sit down, instead, if you're one of the ones who get up and risk losing your seat in order to go around and shake someone's hand, welcome them to church, and tell them you're excited they're here, get to know a little bit of their story, let me just say thank you. It's making a deep and meaningful impact in those who are visiting our church. We had 16 in our discovery class this morning, 16 people interested in membership over the next couple of months as they go through the class for a month, and then, of course, as we establish membership interviews with them. I attribute much of that to the way you have shown grace and kindness to them over the time that they've been with us. If you're not one of those people, perhaps you're a little bit of a wallflower, you're a little bit more introverted, let me encourage you to do something that's a little bit easier. Maybe leave what is a normal seat for you and go and just sit somewhere near, whether church member or guest, someone you're not familiar with. Just decide you're going to sit somewhere different. I know we're Baptist and I know we like to sit in the same seats every single time, but maybe we can break up that model a little bit and sit somewhere unique so that even generationally speaking, older can sit next to younger, younger can sit next to older, and we can begin to get to know each other all the more. And let me just say one more thing and we'll get into our text this evening. Let me encourage you, even as we show friendliness and as we show hospitality, one of the areas I've recognized we can do better is as people begin to walk down the hallways during the Sunday school hour, we're of course catching up with one another and we're getting going and we're getting our breakfast foods. But for many of these people, they have no idea what they're doing and they have no idea where they're going. Now our ushers, our greeters, they're instructed to try and walk them into the classroom and help them understand what they are to do. They're supposed to offer the class offerings. But as a church member, if you're not a part of our official ushering or greeting crew, and you'd like to be for that matter, just see Nate and he'll kind of touch base with you and get you to the right people who are in charge of that ministry. And I think we could use more in it, quite transparently. But that being said, if you're just a church member in the hallway and someone's walking down that you don't know, instead of averting eye contact because you're not sure what to say, you know, one of those where you're looking this way, you recognize that you don't recognize them, and so immediately you start looking at a wall that's a foot away from you for no reason. Instead, just extend your hand, say, "Welcome to church. I'm going out on a limb here, but I don't think you're a member because I don't recognize you." They'll say, "I've been attending here for 7 months." You'll say, "I'm sorry," and that'll be okay. You'll laugh at each other, and then you'll be able to say, "Well, why don't we sit next to each other and get to know one another?" Or, more likely, they'll say, "You're right, we've only been here a couple of times. Well, do you know about our Sunday school classes?" And they'll say, "No," and you go, "Great, me neither. Let's go figure it out together." And just walk down there and sit them next to you and show the love of Christ. Don't expect someone else to do it. You do it. And I'll be encouraged to know that I'm sure many of you, if not all of you, will take me up on that. It honors the Lord, and it certainly creates a fun and a warming atmosphere for those who come and visit our church. Well, we're in 1 Corinthians 2, and some of you are gasping because we're actually regressing in our study of 1 Corinthians. But I want you to see with me verses 6 and 14 and 15. Notice, if you would, 1 Corinthians 2, 6. "Howbeit we speak among them that are perfect." Now again, I remind you, this is Paul speaking about the wisdom of God. When he uses the term perfect, he's referencing that which is complete or mature, that which is spiritual. He says, "Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor the princes of this world that come to naught, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery." Notice verse 14. "But the natural man," in contrast to the perfect man of verse 6, "the natural man receives not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they," that is, these wise truths, "they are spiritually discerned. But he that is spiritual," now verse 15, the word "spiritual" would be a direct comparison. Just like verse 14 contrasts with verse 6, verse 15 compares verse number 6. And so the word "spiritual," the one who spiritually judges all things, is the same as a perfect one in verse number 6. By chapter 2, Paul has begun to teach, even as we were saying this morning, and it's imperative that you grasp, that there are two categories. That there are those who are complete or mature or perfect or spiritual, and then there are those who are natural. And they are in complete opposition one to the other. Even as we begin to study this evening, it would give me cause to remind you and cause for you to reflect on the importance of detailed and intimate study of the Word of God. A few weeks back, we reminded you that there are two primary ways to read the Scripture. You can either read it for familiarity, or you can read it for intimacy. Both are necessary. If you only read the Scriptures for intimacy, diving deep in and studying hard, you won't be able to grasp the full narrative of Scripture. You won't see the redemptive plan of God because you're only localizing yourself to one thought and you don't know the fullness of God's truth. But if all you're doing is familiarizing yourself with the Bible and you never dive deep to study the Word, if you never strive to know it more deeply than just a surface level familiarity, we miss what God has desired to reveal to us. And so we want to this evening, even in going back, want to study to show ourselves approved unto God. The word "study" means to endeavor. It means to labor. It means to give diligent effort. You know what it's like to study. If you're a student here and you know that you've got a test coming up, you, of course, prepare for that months and months in advance and begin prepping so that you would not be caught off guard. Or you cram at the last moment and give all diligence the night before, endeavoring to do the very best you can. I'll let you guess which of the two it is. But you know what it means to give diligent effort to something. And God says that when it comes to His Word, we are to give such diligence, such a spirit of endeavoring to know Him and to see what He's revealed. And so Paul has told us that there are a certain category of human that are perfect, mature, or complete. They are spiritual. Now there is another category, and that category is those who are natural. But he expands, even as we said this morning, on those two previous categories when he says in chapter 3, verse 1, that there are some who are not spiritual and are not natural, rather they are carnal. Now this is a new introduction. And it's important for us to grasp a little bit about the distinction between positional and practical spirituality. And it's important, it behooves us to note this, because I think the word carnal as it relates to the Christian is one of those very difficult issues for a lot of us. Not only are we not sure whether or not a carnal Christian exists, but we're also not sure if we are one. And so I want to remind us, or at least perhaps this evening, teach us that unbelievers at no point can be called spiritual. That's why in verse 14 of chapter 2 they are called natural. They do not have a new spirit within them, and they do not have the Holy Spirit residing in them. But when we speak of the spiritual nature of a Christian, the Scripture, and in particular the New Testament, speaks of his spirituality in two ways. He can either reference his spiritual nature in the sense of his position in Christ. He is spiritual because he's been converted. He is in Christ. Or he could be speaking of his spirituality as it relates to his practice. He is walking in obedience to Christ. Positionally, believers are spiritual. It does not waver. It is their position. They are spiritual because they have been given a new inner being that loves God, and they are indwelt by the Spirit of God. Listen to Romans 8, verse 9. You are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. So this is as clear as Paul can teach it to the church at Rome. You are either in Christ and spiritual because the Spirit indwells you, or else the Spirit of God does not dwell in you, and therefore you are natural or unspiritual, positionally speaking. But the Bible does not speak solely of the spirituality of man as he relates to his position. The Bible also speaks of a spiritual nature as his practice. And a believer in practice can be either spiritual or carnal. While he has a new nature and has been given a favorable disposition to God and has the Holy Spirit dwelling within him, a Christian still has the flesh, and he still has the temptations of the world. Our practical spirituality, whether or not we are practically spiritual or practically carnal, has everything to do with whether or not we are walking in obedience to Christ. It ought be, and how I pray it will be here at Landmark, that the Christian's practice continues to align more and more with his position. That is the argument Paul's making in 1 Corinthians 3. When I left you, I was teaching you milk because you were recently converted, and it was too hard for you to eat meat. But here I am wanting to give you meat, and you're still on milk. And he's baffled by it. He recognizes the absurdity of this. Because though they became positionally spiritual, they became complete, perfect, mature in Christ, in their position, their practice did not identify with that position. They were living as those in the flesh, carnal. And he looks to them and says, those of you who are carnal need to repent because God commands your practice to be like your position. You are to be spiritual in practice just as you are spiritual in position. Where the disposition of the Christian is to honor God because of a new nature, and because the Holy Spirit affects his desires, it ought be for a Christian, when he begins to dabble in the things of the world, an increasingly uncomfortable compromise. It ought be seen as tragic, just like it was with the Corinthian believers, when our practical spirituality is categorized as carnal. And yet, even as I say that, and even as I taught this morning, I want to offer up three questions that I think for us this evening will be helpful. I heard them when I was listening to a sermon on this topic. I found them personally helpful. Because many of us, if we're honest, at times go, well, I understand that I'm a Christian and I'm practically spiritual. Excuse me, I'm positionally spiritual. I know that I'm in Christ, and I know that I have received all the benefits of one who is in Christ. I've been justified, I've been adopted, I've been regenerated, I'm being sanctified. But practically speaking, I don't feel very spiritual. I feel very carnal. I feel that the appetites and the allurements of my flesh and the world are causing me to sin. What do I do? How do I discern whether or not I'm a carnal Christian, a spiritual Christian, or not a Christian at all? Three questions. We'll be brief. Number one. I think pastors just say that, by the way. I don't know that that's actually true. At least it's not the Super Bowl. Number one. What victories have you won? What victories have you won? Or maybe said better, what steps of obedience have you undertaken? What victories have you won? And here's what I mean by that. Every true Christian, if you're wrestling tonight, well, okay, am I a carnal Christian or am I not a believer? Every true Christian who has God's Spirit within him will be able to point to something where he has been able to overcome sin. It may be small, it may be in your estimation insignificant, but there is something you can look to, you can point at, and say, I once was this way, but because of God's work in me, because I've been transformed by his gospel, I'm now this way. I used to be lazy. I used to be indifferent, but now I find myself increasingly aware of the need to be studious. I once was impatient and couldn't stand anything not going according to schedule, but God has worked his grace in me, and while I wouldn't claim perfection, I am far more patient today than I was when I was converted. Perhaps you might say, I used to struggle so badly with the sin of lust, both in word and in thought and in visual stimuli. But by the grace of God, I know I'm not all that I'm supposed to be, but I can look and see that the area of lust has been markedly different in me. Maybe for you, it's an area where you knew you were ignoring God. You knew you were in direct violation. You were transgressing against his law for you. But then you were convicted by his Holy Spirit, and in conviction you responded in repentance, and you have seen marked obedience, marked change. Well, dear Christian, this should be deeply encouraging for you. This is a real victory. He who began a good work in you will be faithful, Philippians 1:6, to complete it, to finish it, to bring it to perfection. He is working that in you. Yes, you may still be spiritually immature. You may be a baby, but at least you're alive. At least you have spiritual life. It is not the place to stop, but it is an encouraging place to begin. Can you think of areas in your life where you have seen increased obedience to God in areas where obedience first escaped you? Can you think of victories won? Perhaps many of us, and I mean this, would do well to go someone who, chapter 2, verse 6 and 15 say, are perfect or mature, who are spiritual, and go to them and ask, what areas of spiritual growth have you seen in me? What areas of spiritual growth have you discerned in me? Listen, church, I say this a lot, but I'm convinced until this becomes normal for us, we will not be the disciples God wants us to be. Until I am able, without awkwardness and without fear, to just go to you as one who loves me in Christ and one who I love in Christ and say, do you see any evidences of God at work in me? Do you see any evidences where I'm killing the things of the flesh and God in His grace is bringing to life the things of the Spirit? Do you see any of that in me? If we can't have that conversation, our discipleship, our practical spirituality will be stunted. We will be dwarfs when it comes to spiritual maturity. And so what victories have you won? Galatians 3:24 tells us, they that are in the Spirit have crucified the flesh. And so even as we wrestled tonight, if you're truly a believer, what are those areas? When you're markedly discouraged, when it's a dark night of the soul, let me encourage you, grab a pen and paper and say, while I may be struggling now, I am acutely aware that God has matured me in this area, in this area. My friend recently told me that they see God's grace at work in me in this area. These are evidences of His grace and the proof the Holy Spirit abides within us. Question number two. This would be a good question for each of us. It doesn't get more practical than this. If question number one is what victories have been won, question number two is where do you need to grow? In discerning whether or not we are spiritual or carnal, where do we need to grow? Is it in areas of finance? Is it areas of temper? Areas of gluttony or entertainment? Is it an issue of anxiety or jealousy and envy, even as we read this morning in 1 Corinthians 3? Are you prone toward discontentment or an ungrateful spirit? What are the areas you recognize where either your flesh or the external stimuli of the world are pulling you down? If you are not able to discern them, how in the world are you going to fight against them? If you don't know the areas where you are weak, how are you possibly going to fortify them? If you are not sure where your army is susceptible to attack, you most certainly will be defeated. And so where is it this evening you know you need to grow? Is it in pride because you are seeking to always impress other people? I would take you back to 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 30, where we learned this morning that Christ is the wisdom of God, and He is for us our righteousness, our sanctification, and our redemption. He is our identity. I don't know what the issue is for you, but I'm confident those who know you best do know the areas where you need to grow. Whatever it is that's coming to your mind right now, I assure you, it is fleshly. It is carnal. And you are not made to love such things. You have been transformed by God. It ought be natural for you to hear spiritual truth, receive it, and cling to it, even as we said this morning with Eliezer to the sword. Where you hear a sermon on forgiveness or rooting out any form of bitterness, or where you hear a sermon on the importance of biblical stewardship, or where you hear a sermon on lust and you know you do not have that, and you know that you are battling that, it ought be that the truth proclaimed grabs you and you know you need it, and so you hold it because you understand your very spiritual maturity depends on it. Do you fight with that type of ardent passion? Are you concerned about the areas you know you are indifferent at present? If not, my dear friend, you are, I'm sure, and I am as well, in those very areas more carnal than we are willing to admit. But let me give you the third question, and we'll take the longest amount of time on this one, just as you thought we were moving along. Kind of made it Super Bowl specific. You ready? What victories have you won? Where do you need to grow? Here's to scratch that itch for you just a little bit. Number three, what's the game plan? What's the game plan? And here's what I mean by that. I don't mean what's my game plan for your spiritual life. I'd love it if you would include me in seeking help and trying to grow and mature in your faith, but ultimately you must take ownership over your life the same way I must take ownership over mine. This is as true as the day we first said it, and it's true long before that, I assure you. Anything, hear me, church, anything at all that keeps you from Jesus is wrong for you. Anything. Morally neutral things, good things, gifts that God has given to us in kindness that you are not mature enough to be able to handle. Those things in keeping you from Jesus are wrong for you. Anything that causes you to stumble, you should get rid of. What's the game plan in fighting against carnality? If you find yourself tempted toward the things of this world, allured by the things of this world, coveting the things of the flesh, what's your game plan for fighting against them? Perhaps you would say, I know I need to pray more. Or, I know I need to read the Bible more faithfully. Husbands and fathers, I know I need to lead my family more diligently. I know I should be gathering my children around the altar, as it were, and praying during times of family worship. Okay, then what are you going to give up to make sure the things that are of great and necessary value get done? If you can now discern the areas you're weak, you know where you need to grow, you know where carnality has weaseled its way into your life, what are you going to do to kill it? What's the plan for fighting it? Some of us have things in our life that, though they are morally neutral, we simply cannot handle them. There is absolutely nothing wrong with a television. Many of us will watch one this evening. There's no problem with it at all. But listen to me, and I mean this with every ounce of my being. Some of us who have one shouldn't, because it owns us. And we have given ourselves to carnality, and while Paul is pleading with the church saying, "Don't you get it? You're still on milk. You're a dwarf when you ought be spiritually mature, and you don't even see the seriousness of it. Awaken to sin. Turn." And you don't. Some of us, the greatest thing we can do is, even on a night like tonight, turn our TV off and leave it by the end of the driveway. You go, "Good night. That's a little serious." What do you think Jesus means when he says, "It is better for you to pluck out your eye and with one eye enter heaven than with two eyes go straight to hell"? That sounds pretty serious. There's nothing wrong. It is a gift from God to have social media. I mean, in what generation could we boast our ability to interact with one another, continents away, time zones away? My wife has family in Spain that she's been able to interact with now for years through texting apps and through social media platforms. That is amazing. Can you just take a moment to grasp that God loves us that much, that he even cares about our interactions with one another? But for some of us, we are so enslaved to those social media platforms, the only thing we should be doing is getting rid of them. You say, "Oh, there it goes. I knew it was coming at some point. The anti-Facebook message." No. Facebook's a gift from God, but some of us aren't able to handle it. And if it keeps you from Jesus, get rid of it. What's the game plan? Do you even sense carnality in your life? One of the greatest dangers is we become so insulary, that we become so isolated. Yes, we attend church, and yes, we're here, but we're not engaged in one another's lives as much as we speak about it, that nobody's telling us, "Whoa, hey, do you see that thing kind of dominates you? Do you notice that disposition kind of owns you? You sure do seem to be in love with that. You're infatuated with that piece of technology, and it is owning you. What's the game plan? What is it that you must do in order to kill sin and become awakened to righteousness?" I am certainly not preaching moralism or legalism tonight. I'm telling you with confidence that the promise of Jesus is this, that if you will trust in Him, He is far better and more sufficient than anything this world has to offer. Leave it and follow Him and find your joy. Thomas Chalmers, I've told you before, this great Puritan author, preached a sermon one time entitled The Expulsive Power of New Affection. Every Christian should listen to the sermon. At this point, it's in a book format. You should just read it. Though it is small, I think the copy I have is 12 pages. You can get it in 30-page format. It is dense. So it is one of those books that you can read in one setting, but that you would go back to over and over and over again. Listen to just one nugget of what he says. In this sermon called The Expulsive Power of New Affection, Thomas Chalmers declares, "It is seldom that any of our tastes are made to disappear by a mere process of natural extinction." Did you catch that? It's seldom that any of our tastes are made to disappear by a mere process of natural extinction. What we want and what we long for and what we desire, what we taste and pursue after, it's most likely not going to go away on its own. He continues, "The heart must have something to cling to, and never, by its own voluntary consent, will it so remove itself of all its attachments." He is driving to our affections, what stirs us to love what we love. And he says, I assure you this, seldom if ever where your affections just die out on their own. Your heart is an idol factory and will continue to pump out any and all different types of idolatry unless you are able to supply it with a greater and more satisfactory affection. Because the heart needs something. The heart must have something. Our hearts were made by God to desire and to desire deeply. But love and desire for the world will always leave us empty. It is not enough to merely see the vanity and the worthlessness and the futility of the things of the flesh and the things of the world. It is not enough to simply expunge ourselves of those worldly desires. The argument of Scripture and the argument of what Dr. Chalmers is preaching is that something greater must replace the lesser affection in our minds and in our hearts. And if it doesn't, I assure you this, whatever carnal and fleshly appetite you have will consume you. Let me show you Paul make that same point that Dr. Chalmers did in his sermon. Go to Philippians chapter 3 for just a moment. Philippians chapter 3. If we must fill our hearts with a greater affection and not simply seek to eradicate worldly affection, how are we going to do that? I have long said that Philippians 3 is my favorite chapter in all of the Scripture. I love that this is now many years after Paul's conversion, and yet he speaks of the Lord Jesus Christ as if he had just been converted moments ago. Listen to the tenderness. Listen to the eagerness. Notice the verbs with which Paul speaks of knowing Christ. Verse 10. That I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings, being made conformable unto His death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if I may seize or possess or apprehend that for which I also am apprehended of Christ Jesus. I don't think I'm perfect. I don't think I'm arrived. Rather, I am striving to possess. I am striving to apprehend. I am striving and giving diligent effort to seize that for which Jesus seized me. Verse 13, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Church, hear me. Do you know what is going to kill carnality in the life of the Christian so that he might grow in his practical spirituality and that his spiritual practice might in fact relate and equate to his spiritual position? Let me first tell you what it will not be. It won't be you and I going, the TV's owning me, the TV's owning me, let me just get rid of the TV and sit in the corner and pray all day and that'll work. It's not going to be, I can't control social media. I'll just delete the accounts and it'll be fine. My heart won't crave anything else. My heart won't desire anything else. I'll just get rid of those social media accounts. I just won't put that in the fridge anymore because that's what's leading me toward those gluttonous desires. I'll simply remove that from the fridge and everything will be okay. It's only half the battle. And I assure you that if we stop at half the battle, we will lose the entire sanctifying war on a day in and day out basis. When it comes to seeking to mature in the Christian life, to renounce carnality and strive to be spiritually minded, it is not enough to simply say no to bad things. Like Paul, we must actively and intentionally say yes to all the right, holy, and godly things. We must, with passion, with pathos, say, I want to apprehend that for which Jesus apprehended me. I will forget what is behind me. I will reach toward that as before. I'm going to press toward the mark. I am striving with a sense, as we've said now twice today, holy discontentment to fill my affections, to fill my heart with that which helps me love Jesus the most. And so what is that? As we talk about game plan, what is it that stirs your affection for Jesus? What holy discipline, when endeavored, makes you love Christ more? For me, I'm sitting in my study in the basement last night, reviewing the notes for this morning's sermon, and I am hit with a wave of discouragement. I mean, just a wave. When you preach, probably nobody even understands what you're saying. It doesn't even make sense. You sure you should be in the ministry? You can sell cars. Why don't you just get out of this thing? Are you sure God even loves you? I mean, all of this stuff just hits me like a ton of bricks downloaded right on my head. And so I do what I know I must do in times like that, lest I become just spiritually anemic. I grab my Bible, and for me, I had never done this before, but because I had just read through Exodus chapter 7, Exodus 7 through 15, where Moses recounts the 10 plagues of Israel, I sat down in one setting last night, reread all of God's working in the life of Moses, Aaron, the people of Israel, as he poured out his polemic against Egypt and declared himself to be the God of the Israelites. If you read Exodus 7 through 15, I challenge you, I defy you to read that in one sitting and not walk away going, God is big, he is amazing, there is no one like him, he is God alone, and there is no one who should ever defy him. And by the time I sat down and had marked up the Bible and circled all the times that God said he was doing this so that all the world might know that he alone is God, my soul was revived. I thought within my own heart, there is no one who compares to our God. What is that for you? Maybe it's not Exodus 7 through 15. It never was for me before. There were other go-to passages. Is it music? Good night. Some of you need to show up to church earlier on Sunday night and just listen to our choir practice. They were practicing this song this afternoon. They'll sing it. I don't know. When are you singing He Always Wins? What's that coming up? Next week. Okay, so be here next week, okay? You'll get it then. So it's just one of those songs that if you're discouraged, if you're finding yourself downtrodden, if you just kind of had a spiritually lethargic week, I don't think that's a word, and then all of a sudden you hear this song And I walk in the back doors and I just soak it in. And again, by the time they're done singing it, because they sang it two or three times, because Monty kept stomping them, but that doesn't matter. By the time they're done with it, I'm at the height emotionally saying, He's always going to win. There's no one like our God. No one can stop Him. The forces of evil will not thwart the power of our God. He is sovereign, and even the devil is God's devil. There is no one like our God. What's your game plan to fight against carnality? And dear Christian, if you do not have it, it does not surprise me that the things of this world appear more alluring to you than the things of God. I'm not surprised to find out that sitting in church tonight is nothing more than a duty until you can finally get home and watch the thing you've been waiting for all day. I am not surprised to hear you say that, yes, you know, God is powerful and sovereign and in control and He's great and all that, but I don't even know how that really applies to me. You who are spiritual, in a spirit of meekness and fear, are to restore those, the scripture tells us, who have fallen. So dear brothers and sisters tonight, it is all of our responsibility to come alongside one another and endeavoring to love and to serve and keep peace, to look to the actions, to the words of those brothers and sisters who are clearly and demonstrably carnal, and call them to repentance, and to see that they find their joy in God. And if they cannot devise a game plan on their own that will pull them from the mire of worldliness and fleshliness, then you sit down and you help devise a plan with them. And if you need them to call you and help to spur them onto godliness, you tell them, my phone is on day and night, you call me, because we are in this together. We've covenanted together. But unlike the church at Corinth, we will not settle to be carnal believers who are content knowing we're going to heaven one day. You're a Christian. That's what it means to lovingly enact discipline upon one another. That when we see a brother overtaken in a fault, we go and we seek to restore them by pursuing them and calling them to their greater joy. It ought be that the first order of church discipline is taking place amongst us all the time. The problem is we don't see church discipline as loving. We see it as judgmental. And God has instituted it that we not be carnal, but that we be practically spiritual people. So what victories have you won? What is in your life you can look to and say, oh, by the grace of God, I am what I am, but I am not what I used to be. What are the areas you've identified where you need to grow? And what's the game plan? How are you going to fight against the wiles of carnality? And how are you going to purposefully stir your affections to love Christ and to displace lesser affection with a greater desire for Christ? I assure you, if you haven't thought through it, and if you don't figure it out, you will be overtaken by the throes of the carnal Christian life. May it not be in us. May we love each other too much than to allow one another remain in this state. Let's pray. God, do in us what only you can. I pray that you will preserve us unto the end, that you will indeed present us to yourself spotless, faultless, exceeding joy. And so now we pray unto the one who alone is able to do that, and we cry out that you will inspire, and that you will influence our hearts to see a deeper and more meaningful affection in Jesus than we find in the allurements of the world. Give us courage. Give us integrity. Give us some type of energy, some type of spiritual discontentment that is willing to say no to morally neutral things that are sucking our souls. Father, the worst thing some of us can do tonight, some of us, the worst thing we could do is watch the Super Bowl because it'll suck our soul. For those who can't handle it, I pray they wouldn't, but that they would find what instead brings them joy and delight in you. And for those who are spiritually mature enough to handle it and to enjoy it as a good gift, I pray that they would recognize it as coming from your hand. And they would strive to use it for hospitality purposes, for theology purposes, ultimately for God-glorifying purposes. But whether it be tonight or 15 years from now, Father, should you tarry your Son's coming, we pray that we will be found not as the church of Corinth, filled to the brim with carnal, milk-drinking Christians who are fleshly and worldly in their pursuits. Grant that we might be a mature, a complete people who in our position and in our practice are identical. For the glory of your great name, we ask these things. Amen. We love you. You're dismissed.